In a world full of movie podcasts, here is one more. Welcome to Defend Your Movie with Sean Donnelly.
The time has come again. The champion must end. It can only be one of us. Victoria!
Everybody, and welcome to another edition of Defend Your Movie. I am your host, Sean Donnelly, joined by my co-host, Andy Fiore, ladies and gentlemen. Today we are joined a very good buddy of ours, super funny comic. You know him from all over the world, really. You perform in Montreal. You perform all over the place.
There's a hologram of me in Shanghai.
Like, what's his name? Like Tupac? Was that you?
I am the comedy Chinese Tupac.
James Mattern, ladies and gentlemen. Woo!
Hi, guys.
We've had you on the show before. Friend of the pod, as they say.
I love Friend of the Pod.
Pod Save America. We mentioned the pod. We should do shirts that say... Really good friend of the pod, like just to make fun of those.
FOTP.
Like, ooh, I'm in.
In the same font that Pod Save America has. How are you, my friend? How's everything going?
Buddy, I'm wetter than a, add your dirty analogy. 80s porn actress.
Oh.
I think they used to really get into it.
Wetter than Sybil Shepherd on The Last Day of Moonlighting. I don't know.
Oh,
she
I like
doing
it.
That show.
Probably, but that sounds made fun. Sense. That sounds
she's
fun.
She's on the Bruce
they
Willis
hated Rose. Each other, so she'd be excited when the show was over. So that makes sense. That joke made perfect comedic sense.
Oh, that's a good job, buddy. I love
there
it.
There we go. Sybil Shepherd. I was at her in my head because I just did that Bruce Willis roast. No, I didn't do it. They just did it. It sounded like I said I did it.
My hologram was there. My Chinese hologram.
Was he there?
Yeah, my hologram. Yeah.
Singing, Hey Mama. Wait, what's that?
Dear Mama.
Dear Mama. Whatever. I took an Uber here, and even when it's so funny, like in New York, GPS, you might as well just throw out the window because it was rush hour and
rain.
And there's rain here in New York right now. So I literally was like, all right, I had to add like 20 minutes on top of this. But then it was really going slow. So I was like, oh, shit. And the guy was a very nice guy. But he was like one of these guys that like – you ever meet a guy who pretends he's very zen but he's actually very pissed? Like – Like, you know what I mean? Like,
totally.
This guy, literally, we were making the right on
You're
my block.
You're looking at one right here.
Yeah. Like, we were making the right on my block, and these two cars, one came, there's no lane on the right side, and, like, literally, a guy came from our right, and there was a guy on our left trying to, like, cut it in front of us right as we turned on the block, because there was, like, so much traffic. And I go, what are these guys doing? And he goes, I respect these guys. They're very smart for doing this, because they cut in, and they're very, very smart, these guys. And I'm like, really? You're more understanding than I am. He's like, yes, that's fine. I when people are smart like this, I am fine with that. And then once he was able to go, he fucking hit the gas and purposely almost hit both these cars together. And he's like,
oh, no.
He's like, that's what they get. That's what they get for. And I'm like, oh, you're just super angry and you're pretending like you're very calm.
He's perfectly centered karmically.
Yeah.
But this same guy was funny because we come over the Williamsburg Bridge. And a little bit early, you know how the GPS will say the instruction a little bit early sometimes? We're on the bridge still. Like, the water's to our right. And the GPS goes, make a right on Clinton Street.
Right.
And the guy starts, like, thinking to himself and pointing towards the right. Like, wait, what? He's, like, pointing, like, towards Clinton Street? Like, when we got – I'm like, no, they mean in a couple minutes.
You can turn over the water. This is not
you can't make
clever.
Light on bridge.
This is not smart.
Yeah, so that was my ride here. I thought it was kind of silly, funny, whatever. But, yeah, it's raining. It's gross in New York City. So I appreciate you guys coming down.
Thank
we were trying to figure
problem.
Out the timing.
Good old-fashioned white guy Uber driver.
Did you?
I was going to take it from Midtown, from SiriusXM.
Please don't call it a good old-fashioned white guy.
Why?
Why does it have to be a white guy? It's good and old-fashioned.
I like triggering people.
Yeah.
Well, that's fun.
I did the opposite, though. Mine was so expensive and was going to take forever. I called an Audible, took the subway, then got an Uber.
That's fun.
Yeah. That's a smart idea because this is far enough
very
east.
Clever.
Where we tape is like East Village, but it's East Village.
Exactly.
So it's you can do that. You can take down to Astor and still
went to Second Ave.
A substantial Uber from there.
Yeah.
Good for you, buddy.
Yeah.
Well, I want to thank you guys for doing this once again. And I don't people out there listening, thank you so much for listening. We're excited because we have a new format on the show. And it's been working out pretty well. The last time you were here, James, my friend, I think you just defended
confidence. Ed Burns. Mm.
Yes, you defended one movie that it's a bad movie that you thought was good.
I enjoy it.
Yeah.
I'd like it played at my funeral.
Confidence, the movie?
Yeah.
Just what? Just playing on a screen behind your body?
Yeah.
Just on a loop?
Oh, it'd be awesome.
Like at your wake, you mean?
Yeah. Either one.
Well, you don't have a wake. You mean like your Shiva? Because are you half Jewish?
No, I don't know if I'm assuming, but I don't know my real dad. I don't.
Oh, right. Okay.
There's people in the family who thinks he's Mexican, and there's people in the family who thinks he's Jewish, and there's people in the family who don't want me to ask questions.
He's a lizard person.
And that person's your mom.
I was raised by Italian German Catholics. Right. I'm agnostic, though, and I have Zen tattoos.
So, but would you ever get a 23andMe or like an Ancestry.com?
I don't want them to clone me.
I have an ancestry. You keep your info, right?
I got
it. Yeah, sure.
My ex-girlfriend has an ancestry. She sent me one. Because I think her family depends on what I am. Could be a little toughy if I was going to marry in. It's just sat there for years.
Really?
Oh, boy. Yeah.
Wow.
You take the girl out of Jersey. Can't take the family out of... whatever. I can't say it right.
Well, anyway, last time you were here, we did the one movie. We used to do it where it's one movie that's a guilty pleasure movie, and you defend it. And that kind of ran its course a little bit, which I didn't realize would happen. Nobody could ever come up with a movie they'd want to do. I'd ask all my friends that are comics and other people, and other people, even people I barely know, and be like, hey, come to the podcast. And they'd be like, you know what? I only watch good movies. I don't have any guilty pleasure movie. Yeah. So I was like, all right, we have to switch this up. So what we did, and if you listen to the past couple episodes, you'll know, it's now Versus. It's a battle royale of the film cinema.
Love it.
On the podcast. So we've done, what did we do? We did seven versus, were you there for that?
No.
We did seven versus,
six.
No. It's 6, 8, 7, 8, 7, 8, 7, 8, 6. Why is 6 for 87? No.
7, 8, 9.
We could have done a numbers one. There's enough number movies.
We could have done number
nine
one.
And a half.
Yeah, exactly. We did seven versus Zodiac.
Ooh,
which is a good one.
And that's then, fun.
What did we do last week?
We did. Well, you and I have done Wolf of Wall Street versus
Departed.
That piece of crap, Departed.
I like the Departed.
That's why I defended Departed. Wolf of Wall Street.
I'll go with Departed.
I'll go with Wolf. I mean, I don't know which one I like better, but that's good.
How about that, though? If I could get a quick plug in for our own show, there's a councilman in Brooklyn, Justin Brandon. He's like an old punk rock kid.
Yeah.
Oh, is
and
that?
I just follow him because he's such a cool dude. And he tweeted out one day, he's like, man, I kind of didn't realize The Departed's not such a great movie after certain doings. I'm like, we got a podcast. I tagged him on it.
Wait, did he listen to the podcast?
I don't know if he ever did, but I tweeted back at him with all our with the link
really
and everything.
Cool.
Yeah, yeah. Justin Brandon. He's a cool dude, and he's doing good work out in Brooklyn for the people.
Oh, yeah. So what was it? Was it at Justin Brandon?
I think so.
Look him up on Twitter, at Justin Brandon. I've been getting messages about people like the new format.
Cool.
So that's good. It's a good sign. And also, when you have good movies involved, we don't have any good movies today involved, but when there's movies that people get passionate about, it's a way better episode.
And people can pick sides. They go, no, you're a fucking asshole for thinking that.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
I want to be called a fucking asshole.
So
for my movie taste.
I'll do that for yourself. I'll do that at your wake. I'll do that.
You should do that in real life.
Randomly text me.
While
confidence is playing on the thing and your dead body's there, I'll go, fucking asshole.
Do you really like Transformers the movie, you cuck? Just 3 a.m, I get it, as I'm getting denied by a girl.
Listen, so today's Battle Royale is, I think it's, I picked them because they're both pretty universally hated movies, and they're both sequels, and I think they're both silly enough that they make sense to go together. That's my reasoning behind picking, because what I do now is the guest will pick one, and then I go, what will work well with that I would like to defend? And today we're doing, your pick was?
Jaws 3D,
which in theory is a great idea, especially for back when it came out. And I'm going to take Caddyshack 2.
Part 2.
So another reason these things are so similar is you're taking a beloved franchise.
Yeah.
Well, Caddyshack was never a franchise. They ended at 2.
Yeah.
There's a reason why.
Well, that's why. the Caddyshack 2 is. But I will say, I think that you Jaws 3, I think, did way more damage than Caddyshack 2 did.
Ooh.
I don't think it did because they made four. I have a feeling they were going to do another after
so
four, but four
money.
Was absolutely the worst
they
thing
go
you
right
could
in
ever
order.
Do.
They go right in order. The four Jaws go right in order.
No, three's better than two.
Get the fuck out
I watched
here.
Two last night. Two's fine.
But it's
two's still got you. Still got Brody.
Three's so two's fun. Two. Yeah, three's fun, man.
I
three's
know
better.
Three is fun. I'm almost on your side here.
It goes 1-3. Two, watching a relative get murdered, watching another relative get murdered, 16 of those, then Jaws of Revenge. That's how you rank those. Actually getting eaten by a shark is ahead of Jaws of Revenge. Documentaries that are long and boring.
I don't hate
Shark
three.
Week on Discovery Channel.
As you guys know, Jaws is my favorite of all time, so like I can't even really hate on Jaws 3. But I do think personally that for me they go in order.
There's a lot of fun things with Jaws 3 that makes it great, and it's not great.
I agree with that.
I see the thing about Jaws 3 that I was going to say is that I don't have fun watching it. I think it's boring.
No, I love it.
Really?
I think
there's so much not boring with it.
That's the one where he's in the water park. Not yes. The water park, the aquarium.
No, it's SeaWorld.
It's SeaWorld. All right, so let's this is why it's the best.
Okay, go for it.
You ready for this?
Yeah.
Cuz Randy Quaid and the other dude play the Brody's children, which their age difference evolves.
John Lupit.
And changes nonstop, right? In the first movie, they're what, 3 years apart? In two, one's 17, the other is 18.
Yeah,
and then in the next one, they're close. It's what. Here's what's great.
Totally.
So Dennis Quaid plays
Dennis Quaid
the oldest
Michael.
Michael Brody. And here's what's great. He clearly was told to play Han Solo. This is right after, what is this, 85? This is right after
Return
Jedi.
Of the Jedi?
Yeah, it's right after Jedi.
No, I was 83.
He's basically playing Han's. This is Han Solo in the real world at a water park. Smooth. He's being Harrison Ford. It's almost like they try to get Harrison Ford and it's like, yo, just read it like this, dude. And so he's playing that.
He's kind of like
a
hero.
He's a space cowboy.
Well, let's figure out why. If you think about it, Dennis Quaid's career back then, he did Quicksilver in like 82, right before that, right? Wasn't that Dennis Quaid in Quicksilver?
Yeah.
Or Breaking Away. Was he Breaking Away? No, that wasn't him.
Inner Space is a little after.
Inner Space is after, but he was already into his own by that point. Early on in his career, he's probably trying to solidify himself as a leading man and a big movie star.
Absolutely.
So that probably screwed him into being relegated into these other movies, even though Inner Space is one of my favorites of all time.
Yeah.
Because you can't. If I met Martin Short, I think I'd freak out if I met Martin Short. But that's early enough in his career. He was still like heartthrob Dennis Quaid. Like, I just got off this bike movie. I'm cool. I'm whatever. So that's probably what they probably, you're not wrong. They literally were trying to make him Harrison Ford to make it be like, wow, he could be the next, superhero, you know, whatever. Not, you know, next, like, you know, leading man in, you know, a franchise.
Could have been.
It's so fun because he's kind of a cowboy. There's almost an accent. They are from New York City. They spent most of his years in a New England town, and he has a bit of a southern draw at times, but yet sounds like Han Solo. And also, they're in Florida. I think they go to a bar that's like a honky tonk. This is it's highly illogical, and that's why I love the star power in this is great. What's it? Emma Thompson's in it.
Leah Thompson.
All the Thompsons.
Louis Gossett Jr. plays Clive Bouchard.
Yes, who goes in and out of being Creole. Great.
And then you got Fitzroy, like the English guy. He plays like the other park owner.
See, here's the thing, though. This is part of the same world. But doesn't it seem like it's not part of 1 and 2?
At all.
Of course.
But
this
kind of feels like it was almost Halloween 3.
And it takes place where? It's in
Florida.
So Jaws goes down to Florida.
Well, no, I think they abandoned the Jaws, whereas in 4, the Jaws Revenge, where me and Alex were talking about it, I was like,
you went away to Bahamas.
How did they know the mom like was on vacation? Like, it was total.
First of all, that shark
we were getting inside
goes back to Amityville and Revenge in 4, kills the youngest son,
Sean,
who becomes the goddamn sheriff.
The sheriff of the town.
Jumps out of the water in winter and eats him, correct?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yep. Yes.
Let's not get sidetracked with how ridiculous the revenge is.
And then takes the express train to the Bahamas to hunt Lauren Gray.
Still a better movie than
Game of Thrones time.
4 is horrible. It roars.
No.
The shark roars. Are you out of your goddamn mind? Like
3
roars like a Dungeons Dragon.
4 is so bad that it becomes full circle good. Like, it's like bad good.
That's how I feel about 3. Michael Caine clearly was going through a divorce or a breakup when he did that. Or he needed a new kitchen. Something went down. The IRS was shaking him down.
No, that's his quote. They go, what was your decision to make Jaws 4? He goes, it had a paycheck. Yes, he said that in an interview. That was a famous quote of his.
Absolutely.
And also, that's the movie where he gets knocked off the boat into the water and they think he's eaten, and he gets back on the boat and he's completely dry.
Yes. And what was his nickname in that? He had
I forget.
Eccentric rich guy. It was ridiculous. Remember. Here, we'll go ahead with yours. I'm going to Google him.
Here's the thing. Yeah, so three, but three is like, at least four is, see, you're bringing up four. Four is more memorable than three. That kind of proves how shitty three is.
No, dog.
People reference four way more than three, they forget about.
Four has that, four might be, I think, the number one worst sequel of all, like, always gets universally voted as the worst sequel of all
15%
time.
15% for Metacritic, four. if we count that.
That's why. That's three is a better movie. Three is a better picture.
15% for four?
Yeah.
Here's the thing about Caddyshack.
Hoagie Newcomb. That Hoagie! Eccentric rich person.
Is that his name?
That's Hoagie. Sandwich.
Yes, Hoagie. Yeah.
It's just like,
I guess,
you know,
Grinder Jones wasn't there.
The people writing these screenplays back then are like these old, grizzled, like, Hollywood writers. And it's like, I knew a Hoagie once. I'm going to put him in this picture.
Yeah, yeah.
Hey, Hoagie Newcomb. He used to sell the newspapers outside my favorite deli.
Well, the names of...
It's
the
like,
names are
Hoagie Newcomb right. Sounds like he has a loan sharking business.
It does.
Hoagie Newcomb, he's like, hey, how can I put my, you know, like that's what it happens. That's why if you watch a lot of 80s and 90s TV and movies, it's like Saved by the Bell is very corny because the people involved in making it were like 50 years old, 60 yeah. years old when they were, well, like 50 years old or late 40s. So they were doing what they thought kids were doing. Right. So movies were the same. Like those screenwriters, they were all within the system already for the past 100 years. So they literally were like, I'm Jimmy Johnson. I'm here, right? The picture, Jaws 3. I'm on contract
right.
with Universal for this picture.
I
have a character. It'll blow you away. It's Hoagie Newcomb. He's a hotshot globetrotter who tries to go after the shark.
Well, I'm outraged. Real quick.
Yeah.
So it does have Metacritic for 3D, but on Rotten Tomatoes,
we don't need that.
11%.
11%
for 3D.
All right, now look up Caddyshack 2 on Rotten Tomatoes, and I'll tell you, it's got to be more. It's got to be more. Because Caddyshack 2, what it has is... It's obviously
it's
bad.
It's such a cartoon of a movie, though.
It's such a cartoon, but that's what makes it so great.
Well,
what is it?
Let's start with Metacritic. 7%. Rotten Tomatoes?
Yeah, 4.
4%!
Oh! Oh, all right, so the internet, as far as the internet's concerned, I put it online and people were commenting and it was pretty even. A lot of people said Caddyshack.
27% for Jaws 3D on Metacritic.
Okay, but that's a combination of,
well,
you know,
because
like, you can't
like,
go by that.
Yeah, I don't know. Here's the thing about Caddyshack 2 is really fun. You still have Chevy Chase and he in it, right?
Oh,
and
but he's such a bad version of Ty Webb. He's got the earring. He's got the diamond earring this time. And he's now the majority shareholder of Bushwood. And then he sells it to Jackie Mason.
Yeah. Jackie Mason, which I'll give you that. It's a bad pick as like the comic. To follow Ronnie. You're not going to follow that. Let me say, we're prefaced by being, it's a bad movie. They're both bad movies.
Yeah.
But I'll say at least.
I don't think he's that bad.
I enjoy
really don't
it.
Think it's bad? What?
It's bad, but it's fun. I mean,
I agree.
It doesn't try. Look, here's the thing. It doesn't try to be Jaws 1. It doesn't try to be skillful at all.
Jaws 2 is trying to be Jaws 1. But,
agreed.
But, and really fails miserably.
It fails badly at it, yes. Caddyshack 2. So I, full disclosure, didn't see it. But it just seems like they went, oh, Rodney's not available this time. We'll get Jackie. We can't get Bill Murray. We get Dan Aykroyd.
Yeah.
Oh, let's get Marsha Warfield. It's so insane.
Marsha Warfield's not in it.
I believe she is, yeah.
Marsha Warfield?
I don't think Marsha Warfield.
No, she's not in it. You didn't see it.
Baby,
did you Wikipedia?
No, man. I saw the previews 1,000 times.
Diane Cannon.
Only kid.
And,
Diane Cannon. Chevy Chase's love interest is in
there's
it.
There's another
Jackie
famous
Mason,
actress, and, but I can't come up with her name. I don't think it's Marsha Warfield, though. Jonathan Silverman.
Yeah, Jonathan Silverman's
in it, yes.
Chevy's in it.
Marsha Warfield, gentlemen.
Who does she play, though?
Hey, baby, don't mess with the kid. My fastball's 98. I don't give a damn.
Who does she play in it? She
plays some woman.
Does she play Mrs.
she plays
Miffy's
Royette
mom?
Tyler.
Oh.
No, Marsha Warfield's black.
That's what I thought.
Yeah. She's in Night Court.
Jessica
Lundy. Mom is white, what?
Robert Stack.
Oh, yeah, Robert Stack.
Robert Stack.
Of course.
Come on, how can you go wrong with the unsolved mystery?
Randy Quaid is in it.
Randy Quaid.
That's what I was about to say. Randy Quaid, even though he's batshit crazy now, and anything he did, he was amazing.
Totally.
Frank Welker plays the gopher's voice. Like, I mean, I can't.
Look at Independence Day. Look at Vacation. And he's funny in this. Like, he's actually...
He's funny in Real Life Boys.
He's funny in... He plays his lawyer. He plays Jackie Mason's lawyer. And then remember he goes nuts one time talking about a dog? And he's like, we're going to chop the dog's head off. he's trying to explain the case or whatever. It's amazing. That's what's funny about it. It's funny. It's funny.
I'll tell you, both of these films amazing, I liked as a kid. I rented them. I was in love with Jaws, and so I would then go rent the sequels. And I loved Caddyshack, and then I finally rented Caddyshack 2. So there's a soft spot in my heart for both of these films.
Yeah.
And I liked them when I was a kid. But I will go back now, and I can sit through Jaws 3D and... I'll turn Caddyshack 2 off.
Jaws 3D.
I'll do the reverse. I won't watch Jaws 3. I'll watch Caddyshack.
I like the dynamic of the little brother scared of the water still.
It has the family. Jaws is all about family. Jaws has always been about family. It has the, if you guys remember in Jaws 3D.
It's about family.
The baby shark.
Like Fast and the Furious. Mm-hmm. It's all about
nurse
family.
They capture it and they try to nurse it back. And then it dies in captivity.
And Mama Shark.
But then Mama gets pissed. Jaws is always about family. So it's always underlying. You got the family there.
Yeah,
the brothers.
It's boring,
they're trying to get Sean Lake.
I think it's boring.
I think when they're in the water, it's not bad, to be honest.
What?
I think when they're not in the water, it's not bad. I like the dynamic of Michael and his girl trying to hook up Sean. And Sean's traumatic still from almost getting killed on that makshift bullshit in 2.
Leah Thompson's
hot.
Yeah, Leah Thompson could catch it.
And it's also like...
I like a water park having a renegade animal.
As a side
no offense
thing.
To Blackfish.
As a side note, Sean might be one of the most tragic characters in film. Honestly, Sean from Jaws.
He's worse than Fredo.
In the first one, he watches his brother go out on the boat, and he gets scared, and he starts crying, and they have a shot of...
Yeah.
Right? Isn't that it? Michael, you know, whatever. And then...
Do you know the Muffet Man?
And the second one, they get attacked, and he sees his friend get eaten by a shark, which...
That girl really who took him on the boat gets eaten.
Oh, that's
but
it
she
is.
Was
okay.
The worst one you could have paired him up with, too, because she was a fucking loony.
Watch him. You can have him.
Yeah.
That's the whole idea. I think she was supposed to be like, you know.
There's some choices that should have been made.
And then
made.
In 3, what happens in 3? He's still dealing with it.
He's still dealing with his trauma, but he meets Leah.
And then, but nothing happens to him in 3 as far as... And then 4...
No, he gets away.
Yeah.
They're
in the bumper boats.
There's always the subplot.
The bumper boats,
Yeah, the bumper
Sean.
Boats.
The banana boats. And then in 4... He dies in the beginning of 4, and he gets... It's so brutal.
The shark has a vertical, right? Like an NBA player.
He gets his arm eaten off. Remember that? They literally have him with one arm in part of the scene.
It's so ridiculous.
It's right after he gets... I think I'm pretty... Because he has the raincoat on, and his arm gets bitten off, and he's freaking the fuck out, and then it comes and just finishes him off.
Revenge is so bad, John Williams refused to score it.
Did he really?
Yeah, he didn't score it.
That's not why he didn't do that. He just didn't want to do it because it was doing a 4. They sign on to that shit early.
John Williams was busy.
Yeah.
I think he was like, hey, man, Michael Caine, I got my kitchen paid for. You get yours, boy.
No, so that's what I think. Like, as far as, like, it's very hard to defend Caddyshack 2, but I was thinking, I'm like, I can defend it easy, and I'm thinking about it. I'm like, Randy Quaid is my main defense, I think. Because that's a direct lineup. We got the better Quaid in that one. If you want to go tit for tat.
Dennis is a better Quaid.
No, Randy's a better Quaid.
I hate to be this guy. I've drank with Dennis Quaid.
Have you?
I've had him serenade me, to be quite honest.
Oh, well, that's swaying the jury.
Yeah, I didn't know that.
He's dope.
Where'd you drink with Dennis Quaid?
So we have a mutual friend who's friends with the band Train, right?
Yeah.
And I go and meet up and we drink with them. And who happens to be in the same hotel and at the whole hotel lobby is Dennis Quaid. He sits down.
Does he know Train?
No, they were just hanging.
Uh-huh.
And so it's like, hey, do you want to go? He plays music. And next thing you know, it's like, hey, do you want to go? We have instruments. Would you like to play? I am now upstairs with drinking wine. With my buddy, another comic friend who was hanging, and Train and Dennis Quaid, and they're trading guitars, they're doing old covers of things. Dennis Quaid plays Gin and Juice on acoustic, it's terrific. He also
might have won the whole episode.
He stumped people, and I'm just hanging. You know what I mean? I know my role, and everyone's like, hey, does anyone know who that song is? And no one knew, and I was like, raising my hand, and I'm like, that's Hank Williams Sr. Kid got some points right there, baby.
Whoa. Basketball still in the 90s. Get some Quaid points.
Hank Williams Sr., baby.
There we go. So how did it happen? You guys exchanged numbers?
Yeah, man.
Now I play bass.
In part three, what was Gossett Jr.?
He was cool, man. It was crazy. It was just a fun time, and I just think he's a cool dude, man.
No, he is cool, but Randy Quaid... What you,
I'd say
you know what that
cast...
night would have been? If you were with Randy Quaid, there would have been meth involved. You would have been on a plane at some point.
Conspiracy yeah, yeah. theories?
You would have murdered somebody.
He'd tell me that John Kennedy killed himself, probably.
Or
Randy,
or
there's footage.
There's a new theory about the... that it's
magic
the,
bullet?
The Secret Service did it by accident when they shot him by accident. Like with their gun, they had their gun out, and it was a second shot.
I love
shot.
All that stuff.
Yeah, it's so silly.
I'm the opposite.
That full we'll have to do on JFK. Believe
it. What do you think it is? We can talk about it for a second.
I think
I am the opposite of conspiracy theories. I think that bullet was magical.
I'll
I
have tell you no exactly what it was.
No, I don't.
Oh no, it was Lee Harvey Oswald.
Yeah, I think it was second shooter. It was mafia driven.
No,
all the
it
way.
Wasn't. It was not. The mafia didn't have enough reach.
Robert
to kill
was
a president.
The Robert was the district. It was the attorney general
who cleaned
and
them up.
He was Robert,
and he was
trying
putting
to shut
a clamp
down.
On the unions,
yeah.
Which was the mafia stronghold. And they knew if they got rid of Jack, that Robert would go away. That's my theory.
I love
I
me some
read,
Bobby.
I, when I was in high school and college, I read every book I could find on the topic. And I my theory like and then I watched if you watch the Peter Jennings special, which some people don't believe, it's called Case Closed, and it's with Peter Jennings. One thing they never tell you in all these books is that with their magic bullet theory, the car they were in, the back seat was raised 6 inches higher than the second seat in the car. So if you do that, the physics of it is a straight line from the back of him into Connolly's hand and drop the hat. It's one bullet. And then it doesn't have to do any turns or anything. It's just one bullet. And on top of that, they say where the conspiracy lied is there was no due diligence after the fact. When he did it, they went, oh, he just didn't. That was it. So was there people that – they did that because there was people who in the government who wanted him dead. They didn't care he was dead. The FBI didn't like him.
So the Warren Commission was a big waste of time.
Pretty much. That was because of the people.
Man,
because
Warren,
after it happened, 65% of the country thought it was a conspiracy. So they had to do that in the 70s.
Yeah, yeah.
People would. It was the end of people trusting their government.
I know right, who right. did it, to be quite honest.
Who did it? Was it Dennis Quaid?
No.
Who?
It was the screaming shark in Jaws Revenge.
That doesn't have a screaming shark
the
in it.
The shark yells.
Yeah.
Yells.
No, we're not defending that. No one can.
No one's defending that. What I'm saying
he says
is
it's
this.
Better than three, baby, and I just touched
that's
it.
Why
it's quite all right. It's, oh, we're friends. It's all right. I'll get your
Bubba, everyone gets weird
Mexican
in here.
Arm. Listen, I think that – I think you make some good points, and I think it's very cool that you hung out with Dennis Quaid. I would actually really love to hang – what was the movie he was in with Topher Grace that he was really good in?
Oh, I know what you mean.
It's a great movie.
It's not a bad movie. Scarlett Johansson's in it.
Yeah.
It's about like, – yeah, I know exactly what you mean. Like, I just can't come up with the title.
Something about a job. It's like the new job. Whatever. It's actually a really good movie and
it's
really good soundtrack.
It's got like all David Byrne music.
Oh, that's
really good soundtrack.
That's the best movie song.
Yeah, like Topher Grace is his young new boss, but then he starts dating his daughter.
Yes.
It's a good movie. I actually saw it in the theater.
It's a good movie. It's a quality movie. But I'll tell you.
Yeah, yeah. In good company.
In good company. There we go.
Never would have gotten it.
I never would have gotten it.
This is my new role for you guys. I'm just going to be your fact checker.
I appreciate you doing that. I think the Caddyshack 2, I still think it has the better Quaid.
I think it has the better cast, actually. If you stack casts side by side... It's got more star power. It's got probably
Louis Gossett
better actors.
Jr.
Yeah.
Louis got
Oscar winner.
I mean, aside
he's
from
he's in one
Iron
of my
Eagles.
Favorite movies ever. You ever see Digstown?
No.
Oh, yes. You never saw Digstown?
Boxing movie, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Him and James Woods.
All right.
They hustle a town. Oh, and Bruce Dern's in it.
All right.
Bruce Dern.
I love Bruce Dern.
Bruce
he's
Dern
terrific.
I like. And you know why I love Bruce Dern now? Nebraska. You watch Nebraska?
I've seen Nebraska, I've been a Bruce Dern fan ever since The Burbs.
Oh,
just
yeah,
because
yeah,
he's got
yeah,
one
yeah.
of the most sarcastic. Yeah. When they go over and they meet the Klopex.
Yeah. Yes.
And because the guy,
like,
Ruben.
Pinocchio. He's like, where are you going, Pinocchio? When he's chasing him.
Yeah, he goes, are you a doctor too? He goes, no. He goes, about a 9 on the old tension scale there, Ruben.
My ex loves that movie.
Yeah, it's a
loves
great movie. Yeah, Joe Dante, guy who directed Gremlins, makes great movies, man. Good, like, beautiful
good
cinematography.
80s
theater.
What?
For my birthday, The Burbs.
Nice.
Like my 10th or 11th birthday.
I saw The Burbs in theater. It was like a freak. It was like a weird, creepy movie.
Yeah, totally.
Strange, dog.
But it was
great.
Really
it's still good.
Yes, at the end when that guy was great. Not Rick Overton. What's his name? He's a Canadian comic that died like a couple years ago. He's fantastic. He's the guy. He's one of the guys in Groundhog Day. That Bill Murray. They go on the tracks with the car.
It's not Rick Overton.
The other guy. Ducommon? Is it Ducommon? No.
Nope. We'll kill ourselves.
I forget what it is. But
the hoof.
The
hoof. The hoof. That's from Goodfellas.
The paw.
Well, I can't believe you're the last one on that.
It took me a second. I got the
come
paw.
On. That was out of nowhere.
It's a sin.
Listen, so I think when it comes to Caddyshack, too.
Rick Ducommon.
Ducommon, that's right.
Okay.
Oh, shit.
That's a fun last name, huh?
Yeah. Nice. He was a Canadian comic. He was around for a long time, and he was so funny. Rick Overton's super funny, too.
Yeah, yeah.
He's a nice person.
Rick Overton? I never met him. Oh,
James drank with him one night. Yeah,
he grabbed the guitar and played Down by the River.
Anybody mentioned on the podcast, James? I got longer with him. I did meth with them. I did coke. So I don't. Let me hear what's your. We're gonna end pretty soon, but what's your final argument for the fact of this movie? What do you think the strengths of this movie are?
Dolphins.
The dolphins are fun. They're like what Betty and Boop, some shit, and they're just talking to them and say, "Here, all right." So this is what's great. So. You could question everything about it, but it has some fun scenes in the water as well. That when the acrobats or whatever, those girls doing synchronized things on
The skis.
On the skis, and then Jaws attacks that. Yes, that's a scene I want to see. Great. How about the rich British dude in his sight, or Australian
Fitzroy's.
Dude? Yes. So this dude tries to kill the shark, gets eaten. This is how wonderfully ridiculous it is. He gets, spoiler alert, everyone, he gets eaten.
Yeah, and then he comes around and is a member of the team at the end.
Yeah, he's still in the stomach and in the mouth with a grenade. And what's her name? Oh. The girlfriend sets it off. Yeah. And he's still got a grenade in his goddamn hand, still not fully eaten by the shark, who still wants to eat everything in the fucking park. Yeah. And thank you, everybody.
That's why it's dumb.
That's the first time we ever see a shark death from the inside.
Inside. It was an inside job. Jack Ruby went and took care of that shark.
The thing that you're totally forgetting is how cool was the underground tunnel. And that was a fucking scary scene.
Dude, there's kids in water. There's people in water almost out. The pressure.
It was great.
I like that the SeaWorld is under. You don't have to think about it. SeaWorld's under attack from nature itself, from the animals that are supposed to be imprisoned by it, which later, let's look at this now. With Blackfish. It gives it almost like some clarity and some actual deeper meaning.
We're like rooting for the rooting
where
the, for the
where
fish.
The fish are fighting back. Then we shouldn't be here.
Yeah. All right.
The case is.
James just took a coaster and put it on the table.
It's my gavel.
That's your bom bom bom. That's it. It's done.
Dum bum.
I think that those are all great points. I think you know what I love about. I love how 90s Caddyshack 2 is. It's very 90s. I like the fact that Randy Quaid's in it. I'll do that as a strength. Also,
was it 90s?
I think it's 89. Or
late 80s, though. Yeah. Definitely late
80s.
It's not. I don't think of it as 80s because it's late 80s,
it's on the
early
tail end.
90s. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
And then on top of that, I love a movie, a mindless movie you watch, that the end, there's revenge in the end. Like when they turn Bushwood into
mini golf
place.
Like extravaganza.
Oh, I love stuff like that. When they have like the uptight people come in, they're like, ooh, whoa, 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 whoa. I love that stuff. So like, and also that they have, that's where the showdown is in the mini golf place at the end of the, like, I love that. Like,
this is
that's
Esther
why,
House.
Even that's like why I love, like, even Dennis Quaid's funny. Not Dennis Quaid.
Randy.
No. What's his name? Dan Aykroyd in it. Dan Aykroyd's really funny in it. The scene with.
I mean, Jackie Mason's Jackie Mason.
He's like not that memorable for him. But it's a great scene at the end where one of the last holes is like the hockey one.
Yeah, yeah, which
and
I loved.
Randy Quaid's on the front. He's like, come on, come on. like guarding the hole. It's just a silly, super, super. Silly.
The exploding
and
golf
then,
balls.
Once again, it's so bad. It's just, it's defiling the memory of Caddyshack, the original. Because I don't think it was Ramis that made it, right? It was just like.
He gets like a story by credit, I think.
Yeah, he wasn't.
And Rodney was even supposed to do it. He goes, I don't think it's going to be a hit. And he pulled out.
Wow.
There's a few guys.
That's
I
so
think
crazy.
It got given to another bunch of writers. But yeah, Ramis.
You watch these things. Because if you watch Caddyshack. because it's not early 80s, it looks kind of cool, too. Like, you know what I mean? Like, it's kind of retro.
Again, I loved it as a kid.
Like, it kind of holds up. You watch it now, you're like, oh, they kind of, like, dress. Like, now the clothes in Caddyshack would be, like, in a thrift store for, like, $400. Yeah. The t-shirts and stuff.
Yeah.
You watch Caddyshack 2, you're like, no, this is corny no matter what. Like, anytime it's corny. But that's kind of why I like it. And Diane Carroll is really sexy in it. And
yeah.
When you're a kid watching Diane Carroll, you're like...
Cannon.
Cannon. What did I say, Carroll? No, yeah. It's...
Diane
it is
Cannon.
Cannon. Yeah. You watch her and you're like, oh, she's like hot. But she's
totally.
Older. But then you're like, she's older.
Though. She's hot. She's country club hot.
Yeah, she's like country club
hot. Yeah,
like,
which is a dirtiness to nice, that.
Yeah. She's thumbing her nose at the country club.
It's why Lacey Underall was so hot.
Yeah.
Yeah, but
she was, you know, like, and they show her boobs and that's fantastic.
But she has that dirty side.
She's a game changer.
That is the best when you're
a dreary old man.
It's a kid's movie.
Hey, Ty, you want to tie me up in your ties?
Ty.
Oh, baby. Maybe, baby, I'll have you.
Well, thanks for doing this. I think I that I won, but thank you so much.
Of course you do, baby.
Hey, we should take a defend your movie road trip to see The Meg. August 10th.
The I'm Megalodon. In for the Meg.
Oh, I'll do that.
Totally.
I'm in.
It looks... Honestly, it doesn't look cheap. It looks like it could be okay.
I think it's going to be great.
Jason Statham. I mean...
Dude, I defend Fast and the Furious constantly on this show because what it takes to make those movies is as hard as making a
great
high
movie.
Drama yeah. that's going to get win an Oscar. As hard.
I'm just a sucker for shark movies. Did you see the new Piranha?
No.
It's great.
It's good.
Watch it. It's amazing.
I want to go see the Meg. If you see IMAX.
Absolutely.
That's where I saw the ad for.
All right, I'm in. And a couple times a year, I go full on at the movies where I get I always get a large popcorn. I'm sneaking in licorice bits for this one. If we're going to do this.
Oh, the minister's snack. The minister's snack.
I'm putting sprinkle licorice right in on top.
Put them right in. Shaky bakey. I'm even going to drink a Coke Zero and get cancer.
You got to stay in the theater this time. So we went and saw Creed. You left the theater six times.
I probably had the pee-pee.
I thought you were getting emotional.
In the pants.
I got no bladder.
Oh, is that what it is?
I'm begging cocktail waitresses two at a time. I just couldn't even get a drink.
All right, don't
even do this shit now.
I'm going to go it's learn a free the country. Casino business.
Oh, he's getting so upset when you said it. You hit a nerve.
I'm also in my head about other things.
That's what I thought. I thought it was like, oh, he's getting emotional because it's a Rocky movie. Yeah. I thought you were just getting up to
I'm done with that franchise, too. I'll tease for the next time I'm back. Could be in 10 months, could be in 10 years.
Oh,
I'm kind of done with this recycling.
What, Rocky?
Well,
so they're making another Creed where it's versus Drago's son. It's Creed's son versus...
Yeah, yeah.
That's what it is.
Yeah. No, it's
yes.
not.
Yes, yes, yep. That's a Creed
too. That'll do it.
Oh, I love
that's
it.
That's it.
Is Tommy Morrison's brother going to come looking for it? What are we going to do here? Antonio Carver, he's going to still come back? Can we stop this just recycling?
I think the Dolph Lundgren will be in it.
Yeah.
That's great. Meddo, we got to stop, but what do you want to plug, buddy?
Nothing. I don't care about nothing. James L. Mattern, you can hear me.
On Twitter and Instagram?
Yeah. On Rant and Raving with Yamanika. You can hear me on Total F and Marks with Dan St. Germain. It's a wrestling podcast. You can check that out. And if you're a wrestling fan, you can come see me at the Bruce Pritchard Roast August 30th in Chicago. It'll be fun. I can't tell you who I'm making fun of. Because the wrestlers will not show up.
Perfect. And Andrew Fiore.
Yeah, you just find me at Andy Fiore, andyfiore.com for all my dates.
And your radio show.
And please tune into the Raw Report every Thursday at 4 p.m. on Sirius XM 99 Raw Dog.
I am at Shawnee Time on Instagram and Twitter. You also can email us, defendyourmovie@gmail.com. Also, we're at defendyourmovie on Twitter. This is at Showbiz Studios. They have a YouTube and they have an iTunes page. That will break down all the different Showbrews podcasts for you. You should check them out. Total F and Marks is one of them. That's my good buddy's podcast. Check those out and enjoy. And let us know what you think of the new format. And some guy just tweeted at me, and he wrote he has a good matchup. It was like a random matchup. Ooh. And I'll tell you about it after. We might do it soon. Thank you so much to Showbiz. Thank you so much for listening. We love you. Goodbye.